Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Overcoming Internet Addiction for Dummies by Dr. David Greenfield, narrated by Peter Lerman. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability disclaimer of warranty. The contents of this work are intended to further general scientific research, understanding, and discussion only, and are not intended and should not be relied upon as recommending or promoting a specific method, diagnosis, or treatment by physicians for any particular patient. The publisher and the author make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation, any implied warranties of fitness for a particular purpose. In view of ongoing research, equipment modifications, changes in governmental regulations, and the constant flow of information, the reader is urged to review and evaluate the information provided in the package insert or instructions for each medicine, equipment, or device for, among other things, any changes in the instructions or indication of usage, and for added warnings and precautions. Readers should consult with a specialist where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for any damages arising herefrom. Introduction. You can only experience life in the present moment. Internet overuse and addiction interrupts the process of being present in the moment and can rob you of the ability to fully experience living. When you're online, interaction with the world occurs through reflections found on a web page, app, video game, or the latest social media update. The internet supports the illusion that you're in two places at once, and it appears to create this dissociation, in part, by the internet's ability to distort time when you're on a screen. Internet addiction is not new. Although the internet may be the latest behavior that we discovered to be addictive, the propensity to become addicted to pleasurable substances and behaviors is not unique to internet use. The structure and function of the reward center of the brain makes you particularly susceptible to the influence of dopamine and the activities that can elevate it, especially when those activities are provided in a variable and unpredictable format. The brain loves the experience of maybe. Addiction is about maybe finding the same pleasure again, or maybe it being even more fun. This is not a conscious process, but rather it happens automatically, thus becoming a neurobiological chase for the previous pleasurable hit. The internet, in a sense, programs you through the pleasure chemical dopamine, and you don't realize you're being conditioned by your screens. Content developers and internet service providers know these basic behavioral and neuroscience principles, and they use and manipulate them to sell you products and influence what you consume online, including how much time and attention you devote to your screens. Many people overuse their internet screens and devices and end up spending far too much time on them. For some, this use rises to the level of an addiction, where balanced living becomes affected, and other psychiatric issues may develop or become pronounced. The internet is a powerful digital drug, and as such, it must be moderated like any other addictive substance or behavior. This book is intended to help people who may lose their way online, and especially for those who become addicted. About this book. This book is written in discrete chapters and is set up with multiple independent but related topics. Feel free to start wherever you like. Some information and key concepts are repeated for emphasis and refer you back and forth to different chapters. The idea is to immerse yourself and start wherever you feel comfortable. I trust that you'll find the information you need to discover, and because this isn't a novel, each chapter stands alone. If you're unfamiliar with this subject, then jump in and start at chapter 1. The book is written to build on basic information and concepts, then on to application, and lastly, implementation. The order of the book presents progressively more interrelated information, such as Chapter 2 on the biology of addiction, Chapter 5 on social media, and Chapter 7 on video games and video game addiction. Part 3 of the book offers information on diagnosis, followed by Part 4, which focuses on living a balanced life with proper screen use. I want to clarify the perspective from which I write this book. I've conducted research and published in the field of internet, video game, and technology addiction and its treatment, as well as workplace internet issues and smartphones and driving. But I still consider myself primarily a clinician. This book is written from a scientifically informed clinical perspective. I've treated or consulted with hundreds of individuals over the last 25 years, many with significant life impacts related to their internet, video game, and screen use. Numerous references throughout the book will represent my opinions based on these clinical experiences, some of which should be considered anecdotal and case-based. I don't represent that everything stated in the book has been scientifically validated, as frankly, we're not quite at that point in the science of the diagnosis and treatment of internet-related disorders. A word about addiction. Please note that this is discussed at numerous points throughout the book, but I want to start by clarifying that the word addiction is perhaps not the best term per se. My approach tends to follow the definition of addiction offered by the American Society of Addiction Medicine, which is deeply clinical in nature. This definitional distinction may seem odd because the word addiction is used throughout this text, as well as in the fields of clinical psychology, psychiatry, and addiction medicine. However, I'm using this label throughout the book because it's the term that most of us understand and relate to when describing the complex biopsychosocial phenomenon that produces something we define as addiction. See chapters 1 and 2. With specific regard to internet and technology addiction, no scientific agreement currently exists on what the final diagnostic labels will be. It is my best guess, based on the state of the research and clinical trends, including those established by the World Health Organization, the American Psychiatric Association, and the American Psychological Association, that the final diagnoses beyond internet gaming disorder may include a variety of internet-mediated use disorders that would involve symptoms of abuse and overuse of internet-based screen technologies. This would be similar to the current diagnostic labeling that we see with alcohol and substance use disorders. Internet use disorders will probably follow suit and will most likely include several diagnoses that overlap or may be related to a specific type of content or internet portal. A quick note, sidebars, shaded boxes of text, dig into the details of a given topic, but they aren't crucial to understanding it. Feel free to read them or skip them. You can also pass over the text accompanied by the technical stuff icon, as it offers some interesting but non-essential information about internet addiction. Finally, within this book, you may note that some web addresses break across two lines of text. If you're reading this book in print and want to visit one of these web pages, simply key in the web address exactly as it's noted in the text, pretending the line break doesn't exist. If you're reading this as an ebook, you've got it easy. Just click the web address to be taken directly to the web page. Foolish assumptions. Here are some assumptions about you, the reader, and why you are picking up this book now. You or someone you love may be spending far too much time on one or more screens, and you've noticed the impact that this behavior has on you, on them, or on both of you. You or your loved one are finding the internet almost too enjoyable, or certainly captivating, and at times you find yourself lost in the bits and bytes of cyberspace. So much so that at times you lose track of time, and also of your larger goals, values, and desires. You want to change your relationship to this useful but addictive technology, or you would like to see your children or loved one regain some balance and perspective about their screens. Perhaps surfing, social media, YouTube, pornography, video games, or never putting down their or your smartphone has become less tolerable and may even seem harmful at this point. You, just like myself, see the unavoidable pull of the internet and screens. You recognize that you need to use them, but that perhaps you recognize that you do not need to use them in the manner you currently do, and you'd like to achieve a more mindful, moderated, and sustainable way to live with your internet screen technologies, as opposed to living for them. You know that the internet and accessible screens are not going anywhere, and that, if anything, they will become even more prevalent and intrusive. You also see that this is not all positive, and that too much of a good thing is not a good thing, and you must exercise your choice and ability to limit screen use. Icons used in this book. Like all For Dummies books, this book features icons to help you navigate the information. Here is what they mean. Remember, if you take away anything about internet addiction from this book, it should be the information marked with this icon. Technical stuff. This icon flags information that delves a little broader or deeper than usual into internet addiction. Tip. This icon highlights especially helpful advice about understanding, diagnosing, or treating internet addiction. Warning. This icon points out situations and actions to avoid as you work to overcome internet addiction. Beyond the book. In addition to the material in the print or ebook you're reading right now, this product comes with some Access Anywhere goodies on the web. Check out the free cheat sheet for information on internet addiction basics, reasons why the internet is addictive, diagnosing and treating an internet addiction, and living a balanced life that includes the proper amount of screen use. To get this cheat sheet, simply go to dummies.com and search for Overcoming Internet Addiction for Dummies Cheat Sheet in the search box. Where to go from here? As I mentioned earlier, you don't have to read this book from cover to cover, but if you're motivated to do so and you want to have a thorough immersion in the subject, starting from the beginning is a good idea. If you just want to find specific information and then get back to work, look at the table of contents or the index, and then dive into the chapter or section that interests you. Sampling a topic can help you see where you might want to delve in further. Please remember that there is hope. There is hope for people to change and for addictions to improve and be managed. Also remember that humans are unique in their ability to learn and adapt, and that the brain is neuroplastic and can change, retool, and relearn throughout your lifetime. People have an inherent desire to grow, heal, and improve, and you or your loved one are no exception. That, of course, in no way minimizes the stress and disappointment you experience when your life or your child's life is not where you want it to be. People are capable of great change, and there are many paths to positive improvement, especially with the resources and professional help that are available. We know much more about internet and technology addiction than we once did, and there are now many more mental health and addiction professionals today who are trained and experienced in consulting on or treating this problem. Part 1. Getting up to speed on addiction basics. In this part, look at the basic factors involved in internet and technology addiction, and examine ways to overcome overuse and addictive use of your screens. You also find the definition of addiction, and you can check out the similarities and differences between internet addiction and substance-based and other addictions. Lastly, you discover some of the most overused and abused forms of content on the internet. Examine the biological and neurobiological basis of addiction and how the reward centers in the brain are involved in the development and maintenance of an addiction. Addiction is a complex biopsychosocial problem that encompasses numerous aspects of your life. Recognize that children and teens are perhaps more susceptible to addiction than adults. Numerous hormonal and psychological factors in the developing brain can leave children and adolescents susceptible to internet and screen-based addictions, as well as addiction in general. Adolescents' unique biological and psychological development provides fertile ground for an addiction. See why smartphones and the internet are so addictive. Here, you examine the unique characteristics and factors that contribute to the addictive nature of the internet and the devices that you use to access it. See how smartphones are the world's smallest slot machines, and how carrying these devices serves as a portable dopamine pump, providing intermittent but unpredictable pleasurable content. Chapter 1. Defining and Overcoming Internet Addiction in a Nutshell. In this chapter, considering the definition of a behavioral addiction, knowing the difference between an addiction and dependence, surveying the important traits of internet addiction, taking steps to address an internet addiction. The interesting thing about the word addiction is that technically it isn't really a medical term or diagnosis. Although used by nearly everyone, both clinicians and the public, it's more of a popularized term used to describe a set of behaviors or a syndrome. Official diagnostic terms for substance and behavioral addictions include substance use disorder, alcohol use disorder, pathological gambling, and internet gaming disorder. For the purposes of this book, I use the term addiction for ease and simplicity. Most people confuse an addiction with physical dependence. Physical dependence occurs when the body gets used to a substance, be it alcohol or drugs. It is characterized by a tolerance to that substance and then withdrawal when the substance is discontinued. Essentially, the body's receptors for that drug become accustomed to having it in the system. When it's no longer available, there are physical and psychological symptoms that we call withdrawal. Remember, addiction is more typically defined as a pathological or compulsive use disorder. This means that when you use a substance or engage in a repetitive behavior, such as gambling, internet use, or video gaming, significant negative effects are created in your life. Despite these negative effects, the user cannot easily stop or may not think they need to stop. This distortion of reality is often inherent to addiction and is also known as denial. We all engage in pleasurable behaviors and at times take substances that are pleasure-inducing. Take alcohol, for instance. Alcohol is a legal, psychoactive substance that has long been associated with pleasurable sensations. But, unfortunately, it is also known for its addictive potential. Many pleasurable substances and behaviors can produce an addictive response due to their activation of the reward circuitry in the brain. Remember, there is some confusion over whether intoxication and/or withdrawal described in alcohol or substance use is also experienced in behavioral addictions, such as gambling, food, sex, or the internet. Clarifying this issue isn't necessary to recognize behavioral addictions, however. Addiction is not simply the intoxication or withdrawal we get from a substance or behavior. It is the creation of a potential set of behaviors and life-impacting consequences reflecting a complex biopsychosocial process. We call it biopsychosocial because it affects our physical health as well as our social and emotional life. This chapter introduces you to internet and screen addiction, how to recognize it, and how to get help. Defining behavioral addiction. There is some confusion about what causes an addiction. This confusion often occurs because of the physiological response of tolerance and withdrawal from drugs or alcohol. But what about gambling? With gambling, you aren't ingesting anything, yet you see all the same markers and consequences of addiction, including an impact on social relationships and psychological functioning, as well as on work, legal issues, finances, health, or academic performance. Gambling addiction, the official medical diagnosis is pathological gambling, is part of a group of addictions called process or behavioral addictions. The American Society of Addiction Medicine, in part, defines addiction as the use of a substance or behavior that causes negative and deleterious life consequences. Addiction is characterized by inability to consistently abstain, impairment in behavioral control, craving, diminished recognition of significant problems with one's behaviors and interpersonal relationships, and a dysfunctional emotional response. Like other chronic diseases, addiction often involves cycles of relapse and remission. Remember, the complex process of addiction almost always involves disruption of reward patterns, motivation, compulsion, executive function, and judgment. But it may not include the physical withdrawal symptoms seen in drug or alcohol dependence. Flip to Chapter 2 for an introduction to the biology of addiction. Understanding how and why people get addicted to screens and the internet. So, what about the internet? And how exactly do you become addicted to a digital screen connected to the internet? Well, the answer is not all that different from how you become addicted to other behaviors and substances. Part of what happens with screen use, when linked to the internet, is that you're accessing content that is stimulating and rewarding to you. But because the delivery mechanism of this digital drug is variable, meaning you don't know what you will get, when you will get it, and how desirable it will be for you, your brain receives a variably rewarding experience. Each time you get a reward, you receive a small hit of dopamine in your midbrain, also called the limbic system. This unpredictability, or maybe factor, is very resistant to extinction, or, putting it another way, addictive. This is the same way that addiction to gambling works, and that is why I call the internet the world's largest slot machine. See Chapter 3 for more information. Each time you pull the handle on a slot machine or click your mouse, you might win. With gambling, you might win some money. On the internet, you might win some form of desirable content. Screen technology is essentially doing the same thing that drugs, alcohol, and gambling do. Obviously, there are differences between the various types of addictions, but the underlying neurobiology is essentially the same. You tend to repeat behaviors that are pleasurable, and the perception of that pleasure is often unconscious and largely biological. The impacts these addictive patterns have are more often behavioral and psychological, but the underpinnings of all addictions are neurobiological. Many people can experience the excitement and rewards of the internet and most forms of digital content with few problems, although you will frequently hear people complaining about how addicted they feel to their smartphones, Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, Snapchat, Reddit, Twitter, pornography, video games, YouTube, and even streaming sites like Amazon Prime, Hulu, and Netflix. The reality is that some people are unable to limit their use of these forms of content online. And because the internet delivery system operates on a variable reinforcement schedule, the brain gets used to the maybe factor that helps produce the addictive response. The pleasure part of the brain, see Chapter 2, responds with increases in dopamine, and the unpredictability of what, how much, and when helps create a digital addictive experience. Obviously, the content you might like and respond favorably to will vary, but the internet has so much available content that it is easy to understand why many people feel addicted to their screens. The reality is that many people are overusing their screens, but may not be addicted. Remember, it's perhaps important to note here that feeling addicted to your screen may not mean that you are. Many of us are aware of our overuse of our screens, but it may not have risen to a point that meets addiction criteria. Nevertheless, it can be a lifestyle problem that you should address by making some changes in how and when you use your internet technology. I talk about signs and symptoms of internet and screen addiction later in this chapter. Remember, addiction represents an extreme problem with a drug or behavior, but it has different levels of severity, just like any illness or behavioral health problem. The levels of addiction can range from mild to severe, with each level representing more significant negative impacts on your behavior and functioning. At the lowest level of impact, you might be overusing your technology and screens to a point where you're eating up too much time and energy that might be better spent on other tasks and activities. At the most extreme level, I have seen people whose lives have been severely impacted and limited by their screen use. It is perhaps fair to say that most of us, at times, fall into some level of overuse, abuse, or addiction to internet technology. Technical stuff. The science and practice of addictionology and addiction medicine define addiction in the same way, whether it involves using substances or engaging in compulsive behaviors. The American Society of Addiction Medicine gives the following more complete definition of addiction. Addiction is a primary chronic disease of brain reward, motivation, memory, and related circuitry. Dysfunction in these circuits leads to characteristic biological, psychological, social, and spiritual manifestations. This is reflected in an individual pathologically pursuing reward and/or relief by substance use and other behaviors. Addiction is characterized by inability to consistently abstain, impairment in behavioral control, craving, diminished recognition of significant problems with one's behaviors and interpersonal relationships, and a dysfunctional emotional response. Like other chronic diseases, addiction often involves cycles of relapse and remission. Without treatment or engagement in recovery activities, addiction is progressive and can result in disability or premature death. Digging into digital devices and the internet. Today, digital screen devices reflect a wide range of technologies and include iPhones and Android smartphones, iPads, Kindles, and other tablets, laptop and desktop computers, and streaming devices and smart TVs. These days, it's very difficult to find something that isn't directly or wirelessly linked to the internet. You will likely almost always have easy access to an internet connection portal, which increases your overall risk for developing an addiction or unhealthy internet use habits. Warning: all digital devices have the power to rob you of your time and attention, and this imbalance creates problems. The power of and attraction to the internet comes from its ability to connect people with other people, information, and services. This has essentially changed the way we live our lives. However, the most powerful aspect of the internet is its addictive potential. The way the internet works can lead to increases in the amount of time you spend online, irrespective of the specific content you consume. Remember, the internet is neither good nor bad. It's amoral. It has no feelings in its power to captivate you. However, you should always keep in mind that the only goal of everything online is to capture and hold your attention. It's not necessarily a nefarious intention, but nevertheless, it's a potent force whose purpose is to keep you screen-bound for largely economic reasons. The only way out of the black hole of the internet is to take back control of your time and attention. Remember, smartphones are the world's smallest slot machines. Their ease of access and availability make them highly addictive internet access portals. And making smartphones even more addictive are the notifications they provide you. Each time you receive a notification of some type, your brain registers a triggering signal that a desirable message, information, or content is waiting for you. This facilitates your continually picking up and checking your phone all day long. There are estimates that many of you pick up your phone 100 times or more a day. The activation of possibly finding something pleasurable when you're checking is even more rewarding than the content itself. Nothing is more intoxicating than maybe. See Chapter 4 for more information on the addictiveness of smartphones and the internet. Recognizing the threats. How do you know whether your digital device has become your digital vice? This isn't an easy question to answer, as everyone has their own personal values about time, and everyone is different in terms of how much disruption is tolerable in their lives. Your technology use is often in part determined by your values around how you use your time and the consciousness you bring to your internet screen use. The idea that your screen use typically occurs below your conscious radar is well established. Time distortion and dissociation are common when you are on your screen. So it's very likely that you don't actually know how much time passes when you're staring at your Instagram or Facebook account, or circling down the rabbit hole on Reddit, or caught in an endless YouTube playlist or Netflix binge. The first step in recognizing your internet use is to become conscious of how much content you're consuming, and to become aware of exactly how much time you have unknowingly surrendered to your device. This is perhaps easier said than done, in that most of the time on your device may be spent without a thought, with little awareness that you have begun a slow descent into the electronic sinkhole of the internet. The following sections briefly cover addictive platforms and technologies. Part 2 is devoted to these topics. Social media. What exactly is social media? I explain in Chapter 5 that social media is a broad category of applications and websites that are structured around the idea of connecting people, organizations, or businesses around themes, content, or interest areas. Although there are several well-known social media sites, the definition of social media has also expanded to include newer apps and websites that attract users' time and attention. Some examples of social media sites are Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, TikTok, Reddit, Snapchat, Vine, Twitter, and YouTube. And even travel sites like Waze and Yelp have a social media component. Undoubtedly, countless social applications are integrated into other apps and websites, as businesses have found that social sells. Some social sites are integrated around news and communication. Others focus on video and text, and still others are simply about photos and user life updates, posts, and sharing. Some integrate all of these features. Most are without fees to the user. However, none are free. Most accept advertising, and many sell your user data to others for a variety of purposes. Warning: make no mistake. If you think there are no obvious payment of costs connected to social media, then you are the payment. Your eyes and attention form the economic engine that drives social media, and many of these platforms have proven to be both addictive and negatively impactful on a variety of psychological levels. Streaming audio and video. Consuming audio and video content, including music, podcasts, and audiobooks, has become commonplace. In fact, most of what you consume in terms of music, TV, movies, Netflix, Amazon Prime, Hulu, podcasts, YouTube, Kindle, and so on, is essentially in streaming format. Even software is streamed or downloaded, and your data is increasingly held in the cloud, on a company's server, instead of on your devices. Streaming means that information and content is pushed to your device in real time, and you watch, read, or listen to it as it is streamed. Sometimes you can download it onto your device and store it for later use. Warning: although no one would argue against the convenience of consuming your digital entertainment in this manner, there are some inherent problems. One major problem is that many of these streaming sites have default settings, called autoplay, for audio or video content to keep going to the next movie, TV show, podcast, or YouTube clip, unless you deliberately turn off that feature. The net effect, no pun intended, is that you can end up watching or listening to a lot more content than you intended to, or have time for. The automatic, pushed nature of the content is equivalent to eating out of a large dish with no ability to measure the portion of food or digital content you are consuming. See Chapter 6 for more about streaming content. Video games. Video gaming is perhaps the most common reason why people seek treatment in our clinic and residential treatment center. Of all the content areas that are consumed on the internet, video gaming is perhaps the most problematic that we see in terms of negative life consequences. That doesn't mean that video gaming is bad or inherently dangerous. In fact, most people who use video games have no significant problem with them and are able to use games with little or no negative life impact. In other words, they can use them in a moderated manner. However, there is a small percentage of users, studies suggest between 1 and 10%, who cannot self-regulate their use and who spend inordinate amounts of time on gaming platforms, including handheld devices, consoles, and PC-based systems. Most of the patients we treat seem to be having problems with PC-based or console games. Video games incorporate some very attractive factors that contribute to their addictive potential. They provide stimulating content that is novel, interactive, and dynamic. Games are always evolving through updates and modifications to keep the novelty and challenge factor high. When playing a video game, you can experience a level of growing mastery that often creates a sense of accomplishment. You might develop greater efficacy in your skills and a higher ranking in comparison to other users. The game provides a sophisticated variable ratio reinforcement and reward structure, the maybe factor, and this structure is modified and changed to maintain user interest and to maximize the dopamine pleasure response. All forms of internet communication facilitate some degree of social connection and group interaction, albeit in a two-dimensional online format, but many video game users find the social component of video gaming to be quite compelling. Many times, gamers are communicating verbally, on a headset, via apps such as Discord or others, and the conversations may not only be about the game being played. Flip to Chapter 7 for more about video games. Online gambling. Although online gambling is technically illegal in the United States, many sites can be accessed offshore and also found on the dark web, covered later in this chapter. The problem with gambling is that it is potentially quite addictive to begin with. But when you combine this stimulating form of content with an online interface, it becomes even more appealing. Online, there are no thresholds to cross and no one to look in the eye. All you have is unfettered, easy, accessible content that is both fun and highly addictive. Online gambling removes the last vestiges of human interaction from the equation, in that it's an easy pick-and-click activity with no personal interaction. See Chapter 8 for more information. Online shopping. Shopping can certainly be addictive, and it can elevate your dopamine levels in the same way that many substances and behaviors do. However, what could possibly be bad about the amazing convenience of shopping online? I do it several times a week, and it certainly makes my life much easier. But the dark side to this convenience is that you're divorced from the impact of your shopping by the ease of being able to search and click and then receive the item within a day or two. Amazon has this down to a science, and they know that the average consumer will almost always purchase more than they ordinarily would because of that ease of access and convenience, and by the fact that they bombard you with reminders and images of what you looked at and what you might need or should buy. You're pushed to click some more. This consumer science has the effect of making you less conscious of your purchases, at least until the bill comes. Rarely a month goes by that I am not surprised by how much I have spent at Amazon. Sometimes online shopping can just be a little too easy. Chapter 8 has more details about online shopping. Online investing. Stock trading and online investing are a perfect match for the internet. Just like shopping, see the previous section, it allows you ease, convenience, and relative privacy, and it makes trading stocks and other investments simple and near instantaneous. The problem is that sometimes you need time to think about your investments, and you can easily make an impulsive move online. There is a tendency with all online transactions to end up in a pick-and-click pattern that feels good in the moment, but may not always be the best choice. Granted, you can make bad investments offline as well. But again, when you are online, there is no threshold to cross, no one to easily call and speak with on the phone, and no one to run things by. Sometimes all that is fine, and if online stock trading is the end point of a well-researched and thought-out choice, then it can work. But as with online shopping, it is just you and your screen, so there is some potential for higher risk in an online transaction. Our research shows that users tend to be more uninhibited and impulsive online than with other modalities. When you are online, you are in essence isolated and more apt to make riskier decisions. The addictive component is also important to note here, in that each time you buy a stock or make an online trade, you're getting a small hit of dopamine. This occurs irrespective of whether that investment is a good one or not, and therefore may be misleading in terms of your judgment. See Chapter 8 for more about online investing. Online sex and pornography. No discussion of online addiction would be complete without a discussion of pornography. In terms of reasons for people seeking treatment and general complaints about internet addiction, it is on the top of the list, along with video gaming. In some sense, the pornography and adult entertainment industry contributed to the early development and adoption of the internet. The porn industry spearheaded some of the first examples of using the internet to provide online adult entertainment to users, and was an early example of effective e-commerce. The ease of access, disinhibition, dissociation, privacy, and perceived anonymity of the internet makes it a near-perfect medium for pornography, and the fact that there are no boundaries and endless choices further facilitates the potential for addictive use. Of those who use online porn, most report overusing it at times, and a sizable percentage feel addicted to it at least part of the time. Many other sexual behaviors are also available online that can become addictive, including visiting webcam sites, watching private video shows, engaging in video or phone sex, and websites featuring various forms of real-time sex work. In addition, there are numerous hookup and sex sites that use an online platform to connect buyers and sellers of these services, as well as prostitution. Again, many of these activities existed prior to the internet, but the internet is a clear amplifier and facilitator, and makes the use and abuse of these behaviors all too easy. When it comes to sex, you have a double hit, in that sex is one of the primary reward drives in the brain. And along with the addictive medium of the internet, there can be an amplification of the addictive risk potential. The dark web. Warning. The dark web is an offshoot of the internet and can offer many things, legal and illegal, that cannot be found on the normal internet browsers, such as Google, Chrome, Safari, Firefox, and Microsoft Edge. A plethora of illegal pornography, drugs, and other illicit merchandise and services are available on the dark web, but there are also monitors in place where you can be caught accessing this illegal information or merchandise. Anything and everything is available on the dark web, and it remains the true Wild West of the internet, and you do not know whom you are dealing with. My general advice is to avoid its use, and if you have any issue with addiction to substances or online pornography, this can be a dangerous place. The dark web does not have some of the online checks and balances, as limited as they are, that normal browsers afford. Identifying the signs and symptoms of internet and screen addiction. Following is a general list of things to look out for to determine whether you may be suffering from an addiction to the internet. Sometimes, just developing an awareness of what you're doing can increase your self-consciousness enough to cause you to change your habits and patterns. This is a good place to start. Generally, small changes can be valuable, but you can make those changes only if you are really aware of what you're doing. Chapter 10 has more information on identifying signs and symptoms, and Chapter 11 provides a number of self-assessments. Remember, every accomplishment starts with a goal, followed by an assessment of where you are, and a plan for where you want to be. 1. Do you spend more time online on your screen devices, computer, laptop, tablet, smartphone, or smart TV, than you realize? 2. Do you mindlessly pass time on a regular basis by staring at your smartphone, tablet, computer, or smart TV, even when you know there might be better or more productive things to do? 3. Do you seem to lose track of time when on any of your screen devices? 4. Are you spending more time with virtual friends as opposed to real people nearby? Obviously, during the COVID pandemic, this is a difficult question. 5. Has the amount of time you spend on your smartphone or the internet been increasing? 6. Do you secretly wish you could be a little less wired or connected to your screen devices? 7. Do you regularly sleep with your smartphone under your pillow or next to your bed? 8. Do you find yourself viewing and answering texts, tweets, snaps, posts, comments, likes, IMs, DMs, and emails at all hours of the day and night, even when it means interrupting other things you are doing? 9. Do you text, email, tweet, snap, IM, DM, post, comment, or surf while driving or doing other similar activities that require your focused attention and concentration? 10. Do you at times feel your use of technology decreases your productivity? 11. Do you feel uncomfortable when you accidentally leave your phone or other internet screen device in your car or at home, if you have no service, or if it is broken? 12. Do you feel reluctant to be without your smartphone or other screen device, even for a short time? 13. When you leave the house, do you typically have your smartphone or other screen device with you? 14. When you eat meals, is your smartphone always part of the table setting? 15. Do you find yourself distracted by your smartphone or other screen devices? If you answer yes to 50%, 7 or 8 or more of these questions, then you may want to examine your internet and screen use. Remember, here's an important disclaimer. It should be noted that no medical or psychiatric diagnosis can be made solely from a written test or screening tool. These internet and screen addiction diagnostic criteria are intended for educational and informational purposes only and are not a substitute for professional medical advice. If you are concerned about your smartphone, internet, or screen use, you may want to consult with a licensed mental health or addiction professional with expertise in internet and technology addiction. Remember, the main thing to look out for is an overall lack of awareness of how much time you're spending on your screens. The more time, the more likely your life will be out of balance. The content or app is not the most important thing here. Rather, it is the amount of time you are diverting from balanced, real-time living. The power of the internet, in part, comes from its ability to dissociate you from real life and to become a digital drug by impacting dopamine levels in your brain. Recovering from internet and screen addiction. You cannot change anything in your life unless you have honest self-appraisal and feedback. The problem with addiction is that often self cannot accurately see self, and people have a great capacity for denial and self-deception when engaging in addictive behaviors that impact their brain reward centers. Recovery always begins with honest self-evaluation, often with some objective data to help you accurately see what you're doing online. With substance as well as behavioral addiction, there are well-established methods for assessing overuse and life impacts from an addiction. However, there is no simple answer for how much is too much, nor is there an easy fix. As I note throughout this book, addiction is complex and involves mind, body, and spirit, impacting many aspects of your functioning. That said, everyone has a different bottom line where they can no longer ignore the fact that their screen addiction is hurting their life in some way. The following sections introduce two options for recovery: self-help and professional help. Tip: one thing you do have with internet addiction is a digital footprint. That is, everything you do online and on your smartphone can be tracked, and you can see how much time you spend, what websites and apps you use, and what content areas you seem to have a problem with. This feedback can be critical in helping you start the process of recovery by seeing what you're doing, much like keeping a record of the foods you eat when attempting to eat better or lose weight. There are many aftermarket apps and programs that can record, track, block, and monitor your internet and screen use. Most cell phone manufacturers and service providers have apps that offer a great deal of detailed information on your use. Several companies also produce software that you or an IT professional can install on all your screen devices that can give you accurate and detailed data, which provides you with total usage information and any problem content areas. See Chapter 11 for more options regarding self-help resources. Remember, don't be surprised when you look at your usage information and find that it is much greater than you recall it being or that you were aware of. This is normal and is part of that dissociation and time distortion that I talk about earlier in this chapter. It is essential that you get accurate feedback about your use. Otherwise, you'll be unable to take control of your screen time. Exploring self-help options. Self-help options, covered in Chapter 12, have always been a substantive part of any addiction recovery and treatment plan. The most well-known is Alcoholics Anonymous, but there are 12-step and recovery and support programs for nearly every addiction. There are even specific support groups for pornography and sex addiction, including Sex and Love Addicts Anonymous, Sex Addicts Anonymous, and Sexaholics Anonymous. There are also many support and self-help groups for internet and technology addiction, groups like Game Quitters, OLG Anon, Online Gamers Anonymous, and others that focus on video gaming and other forms of screen use can be useful. But beware that many of these groups are themselves online. Some might argue that this defeats the purpose, but my experience suggests that some help is always better than no help, even if it's online. COVID also gave us new reliance on the utility of telemedicine, mental health, and addiction treatment. Self-help books and resources can be invaluable in making desired changes in any behavior or addiction. When I first started my work in internet addiction in the late 1990s, only one self-help book, Caught in the Net, published in 1998 by Dr. Kimberly Young, was available. And my book, Virtual Addiction, was the second, published in 1999. Now, literally dozens of books and resources have been written, and a great deal of medical and scientific research has been conducted on the subject. We know a lot more about this new addiction than we did 25 years ago. See Chapter 12 for more on self-help strategies. Getting professional help. Sometimes, self-help and support groups aren't enough to make the changes you need in your life. Breaking an addiction can be hard, and any behavior change can sometimes be made easier with professional help. My recommendation would be to find a psychologist, psychiatrist, or therapist who has experience in addiction and addiction medicine, preferably with a background in internet, video game, or screen addiction. Don't be afraid to ask questions regarding their experience and expertise in this area, and be wary of any doctor or therapist who underplays the issue and tells you it isn't a real problem. Remember, for the last 20 years, I supervised psychiatry residents and taught courses on internet addiction and sexual medicine at the University of Connecticut School of Medicine in the Department of Psychiatry. I have trained many doctors and therapists on how to treat this issue, so please make sure you find someone who has some training and/or experience in this specialty area. See Chapter 13 for more about finding professional help. Raising tech-healthy children. At least two generations have now been raised on internet and screen technologies. I wish I could unequivocally say that this has been a good thing. The internet and digital screens are unquestionably a great innovation and have changed the world in many positive ways. But there have been some negative changes as well. There are clear brain and behavioral changes from excessive screen use. It seems that the internet can change the way you think, or at times make thinking less important. It also impacts your ability to delay gratification and may impact social and empathy development. And there is growing evidence to suggest that today's youth have developed mental health problems from excessive smartphone, screen, and social media use. However, perhaps the biggest issue with children and teens is the incredible amount of time they spend on their devices and the way it impacts their real-time social interactions, physical activity, and relationships. This life imbalance is palpable and can cause real issues in overall health and well-being. This is not to say that everyone who uses internet and screen technologies needs treatment or even has a problem, but some of the data is certainly a cause for concern. Remember, the goal is to teach children responsible and sustainable use of technology and how to use their screens in limited and balanced ways. See Chapter 15 for more information. Balancing technology with real-time living. Anything in excess can produce negative health issues, and the internet and screen technologies are no exception. Health issues relating to screen use have been well established and may involve reduced and poor sleep, increased stress and elevated cortisol, repetitive motion injury, and neck and back problems. There have been reports of thumb, finger, and upper back problems from excessive screen use, as well as eye strain and difficulties focusing. Some reports of more serious medical issues include elevated blood pressure, blood clots, weight gain from sedentary behavior, and heart rate issues from dehydration. In extreme cases, people have died. Health is in large part determined by balance in your life. Screens and all the content you endlessly consume online may interfere with that balance. But balance is key. It can be hard to maintain because it involves conscious choices, but it is necessary for healthy living. After treating hundreds of patients with internet and video game use issues, and having used the technology myself for the last 30 years, I have come to believe that it is anything but benign. It eats up your attention and can rob you of the most important resource in your life, your time, without your even knowing it. People constantly embrace new technology, faster smartphones, companies are now rolling out 5G, faster processors, bigger and better screens, more apps, and more devices connected to the cloud and running their daily lives. This, in some ways, represents progress, but in many ways, it is a setback. All this technology requires more and more time and attention to manage, maintain, and learn how to use. I cannot tell you how many times I have had to troubleshoot a problem with some digital device, install a new app, or just change my password for the millionth time. All of this takes time. All of this takes energy. All of this takes attention from other, perhaps more meaningful and satisfying parts of your life. All of this attention to our tech adds up. Remember, sure, all this convenience is wonderful, but is it really making life happier and satisfying? I'm not so sure. Has all your screen and internet use really added quality to your life? Just because you can hook everything in your life up to the internet does not literally mean it will improve the quality of your life. You always must ask yourself the question, will the cost, time, really be worth the ultimate benefit? Chapter 14 has details on finding balance in screen use. Chapter 16 warns you of how the internet is only going to become more addictive. Understanding the end of privacy as you knew it. The following sections cover a few of the features of the internet that many of you may experience as inherent strengths of being online, but many are an illusion when looked at more closely. Recognizing the myth of anonymity on the internet. Anonymity is a myth on the internet, as there is no such thing as real privacy online. When we conducted our original research in the late 1990s, several items stood out. Not surprisingly, perceived anonymity was a significant factor in contributing to the appeal of the internet. It seems there was a perception that the internet and all things communicated online felt like they were anonymous, but nothing could be further from the truth. Virtually everything you do and say, type, text, post, search, and scroll online is trackable, traceable, and in some cases, recorded and reproducible. That is not to say that everyone is reading and listening to what you do online, but rather to demonstrate that there is a footprint of what you do and say online. In general, you should remember that online communications are anything but anonymous. There are countless cases where users are startled to find out that what they do and say online can be accessed by others. And this record appears to be rather permanent. All this is said not to make you paranoid, but rather to be mindful that privacy online is complicated, and it's best to remember that. Remember, nothing online, and I mean nothing, is private. Understanding the disinhibition phenomenon. Another important phenomenon is disinhibition. We do not entirely know why people often feel disinhibited or freer to express thoughts and feelings online. Sometimes that can be a good thing, but at times you can say things that might be better left unsaid. When on social media or other communication apps, it's important to remember that the act of communicating online via text seems to bypass some neurological processing that might act as a buffer in verbal interactions. This may be due to differences in processing and less use of the frontal part of the brain that manages impulsivity, although this has not been formally established. The disinhibition you feel when communicating online can also impact your perception of intimacy. We found that when users communicate online, they can feel more connected and intimate with those they communicate with. However, this level of intimacy does not seem to reflect the same types of intimacy that occur through other modes of communication and connection. Although online communication is useful for work and social connection, it can lack some of the cues, boundaries, depth, nuance, and markers that allow real-time connection to establish deeper aspects of relatedness. The ironic fact is that people often feel more intimate more rapidly online, even though it is questionable whether this is analogous to real-time social connection. I have many patients who reported feeling almost instant closeness online, only to find it didn't cross over well in person. Cybersecurity, cyberstalking, and cyberbullying. Remember, unfortunately, because everything online is vulnerable to hacking, there is a risk that sensitive information, such as finances or other personal data, can be hacked into, stolen, ransomed, or corrupted. Nothing is fully safe and secure online, and care must be taken to protect sensitive and private information, including, but not limited to, financial data. The openness and easy accessibility of the internet, along with the proliferation of social media, have created a firestorm of problems with cyberstalking and cyberbullying, as it is easy to troll someone online and track their digital and social footprint. Even more damaging, however, is the ease and relative frequency with which cyberbullying can occur. When someone says something about someone online, it's difficult to erase the sting and stain of what is said. Perhaps the worst part is that a powerful feature of the internet is its broadcast capability, and this makes cyberstalking and cyberbullying that much easier. Anyone can say anything online, and short of overt hate speech and sometimes including it, it's easy to get away with saying some psychologically damaging things about someone. This is an all-too-common occurrence for children, tweens, and teens, and there have been numerous cases where significant emotional damage was done, and that, in some cases, resulted in suicides. Remember, the internet is powerful and can be used to communicate with others, but care must be taken to remember that everything said online is amplified and potentially broadcast to the world. Chapter 2. Studying the Biology of Addiction. In this chapter, finding out how addiction is linked to evolutionary survival. Discovering how the brain is susceptible to addiction. Checking out the parts of the brain involved in addiction. Addiction can produce numerous negative psychological and behavioral effects. A large part of the addiction process is directly connected to the neurobiology of the brain, the topic of this chapter. Understanding the evolutionary biology of addiction. The biological factors relating to addiction are primarily associated with the limbic system of the brain. The limbic area is found in the middle of the brain, and it sits on top of the brainstem and lower brain structures, sometimes called the old or reptilian brain, and just under the neocortex, the wrinkled gray part of the brain, the one you think of when you picture a human brain. Neo refers to the newer section of the brain. Newer in the sense that it was the last to develop in our evolution. The limbic part of the brain is much older than the neocortex. Its development is often associated with emotion and more primitive survival functions, and it's sometimes referred to as the mammalian brain. It has a long evolutionary history, having evolved over millions of years in mammals, far predating human evolution. Much of the limbic system's job involves supporting various essential activities that developed to ensure species survival. By comparison, the neocortex is probably only about 200,000 years old, and as such, it's a relatively new arrival on the block when it comes to brain development. So, what does the limbic area of the brain have to do with addiction? The answer is plenty. And it makes a lot of sense when looking at the relative utility of all biological structures and functions throughout the history of our species and understanding that nothing occurs by accident. This all becomes clear when you examine these functions throughout our evolutionary development. The following sections walk you through the brain's evolution when it comes to addiction. Discovering humans' original addictions. Many brain structures involved in our survival have to do with pleasure, such as the ventral tegmental area, substantia nigra, amygdala, anterior cingulate, prefrontal cortex, hippocampus, and nucleus accumbens. Chapter 3 has more details. However, the nucleus accumbens, NA, located in the brain's limbic system, is the major source of the experience of pleasure. Remember, the nucleus accumbens is a dense collection of cells that are specifically receptive to dopamine. Dopamine is one of the major excitatory neurotransmitters responsible for pleasure and movement. So, why would our survival be linked to an excitatory pleasure neurotransmitter? Well, as nature would have it, a mammal's survival is at least minimally based on the ability to engage in two behaviors on a predictable, consistent, and efficient basis. In other words, nature essentially needs a strong guarantee from a genetic survival perspective that can increase the odds of survival. These two behaviors, not surprisingly, are sustenance, eating and all the behaviors associated with obtaining and consuming nutrition, and procreation, mating. Obviously, adequate nutrition is necessary for effective procreation as well. The interesting thing here is that food, or more specifically eating, is highly pleasurable. A strong biological pleasure drive, not just hunger, is linked to consuming food, and this is nature's way of ensuring that food is consumed. So, when we eat, we experience an associated strong elevation of postsynaptic dopamine in the nucleus accumbens. This flood of dopamine is experienced as pleasure. Just think about your last great meal or the intensity of pleasure your dog seems to experience when eating. Food is extremely pleasurable and satisfying to consume for all mammals. Even without language or consciousness to understand this connection on a strictly biological level, this pleasure increases the likelihood of a behavior being repeated reliably and consistently, thus ensuring survival. The same applies to procreation and sex. Obviously, it would make sense to make procreation pleasurable on some level. Not just humans, but all mammals have dopamine linked to their mating behavior. This is nature's hedge to increase the odds of fulfilling the biological imperative, to get genes transferred into the next generation. This is the basic survival instinct that accounts for at least part of human behavior. The circle of life, if you will. Distinguishing the new brain from the old brain. Sometimes we hear references to new brain and old brain. However, that is not entirely accurate. When we refer to new brain or old brain, what we're really talking about is how the different parts of the brain developed from an evolutionary biological perspective. As mammals evolved over eons, the brain developed in increasing complexity from the bottom up. This means that as evolution moved forward, it progressed from the lower brain, including the upper brain stem, to the midbrain or limbic system, where the reward centers are, and finally to the latest development in our neurobiological evolution, the neocortex, or new brain. By the way, it's the prefrontal part of the cortex that helps inhibit the more animalistic survival drives that emerge from the more primitive limbic structures of the brain. And addiction is one of those hijacked drives piggybacked onto the limbic reward center gone awry. Identifying the parts of the brain involved in addiction. Many areas of the brain are involved in addiction, and most of them are found in the limbic system. The interesting thing about addiction is that it isn't simply about dopamine and the pleasurable feeling it provides. Numerous other systems are involved with addiction, including the endocrine system and certain hormones, as well as other neurotransmitters. The major areas of the brain involved in addiction include the ventral tegmental area, substantia nigra, amygdala, anterior cingulate, prefrontal cortex, hippocampus, and nucleus accumbens, also discussed in Chapter 3. The nucleus accumbens is the major area in the limbic region of the brain. It's a dense bundle of cells where a very large number of dopamine receptors reside. Dopamine is one of the major excitatory neurotransmitters responsible for pleasure and movement, and along with serotonin and norepinephrine, it has a lot to do with mood, reward, motivation, pleasure, and compulsion. Neurotransmitters are chemicals that enable nerve cells to communicate with one another. The nucleus accumbens is the major traffic center for pleasure for most of the things we do. And as mentioned earlier, the brain is wired to make sure that certain behaviors associated with survival and thriving are pleasurable. It makes sense that nature would do this, as it increases our survival potential. Figure 2-1 shows the reward centers of the brain. Remember, as you read the following sections, keep in mind that addiction involves borrowing those pleasure pathways meant for survival. So, in an odd way, addiction is really a natural phenomenon gone awry, much like many medical conditions. It's also important to note that the human brain and nervous system are always about checks and balances, where excitatory neurotransmitters are held in check by other inhibitory neurotransmitters, such as GABA or GABA, also known as gamma-aminobutyric acid. Examining the role of neurons and neurotransmitters. Remember, neurons are essentially the central part of the electrochemical connection process that makes up our nervous system. Most of what we're talking about with addiction involves the central nervous system, where neurons do their job. The central nervous system includes the brain and spinal cord. A neuron is made up of three major parts, as shown in Figure 2-2. Soma, or cell body. Dendrites, which are the connecting strands that allow all neurons to interconnect. Axons, which are the fibers that act like electrical cables, connecting cell bodies to their dendritic terminals. Obviously, this is an oversimplified explanation, but suffice it to say that the power of the human brain derives not only from its constituent lobes and functional centers, but from how they all interconnect and communicate. Neurotransmitters are the chemicals that allow neurons to communicate and connect with each other. Many neurotransmitters are in the central and peripheral nervous system, the major ones being dopamine, serotonin, norepinephrine, GABA, acetylcholine, glycine, and glutamate. The three that we frequently deal with in psychiatry, psychopharmacology, and addiction medicine are dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine, although we have recently begun targeting and integrating some of the other neurotransmitters as well. The way in which neurons connect is quite amazing and is a combination of electricity and chemistry. Without getting into the weeds here, each neuron is typed to a specific neurotransmitter, and for the most part, only uses that neurotransmitter for firing its respective neurons. Here's how it works. See Figure 2-3. An electrical signal moves through an axon, the electrical cable I mentioned earlier, and this signal traveling along the biological wire is called propagation. Some unique aspects of the axon help facilitate this propagation and make it as fast and efficient as possible. A special superfast coating exists along the axon called myelin, and this myelin sheath allows for a faster electrical transmission. Nature also uses other tricks to keep nerve signals moving along. Many axons also have built-in speed bumps called nodes of Ranvier, shown in Figure 2-2, which essentially allow the electrical signal to jump across the tips of these nodes to speed up transmission. This is in part what allows our nervous system to operate at lightning speed, and this leaping is called saltatory conduction. That electrical signal comes barreling down the axon to a gate, actually a gap, called a synapse. When it reaches the synapse, or gap, a seemingly magical thing occurs. The electrical signal is converted to a chemical one by facilitating an action potential that commands the presynaptic membrane, one end of the axon, to release its store of the associated neurotransmitter. This transmitter is then taken up, the term is uptake, into the postsynaptic receptor, and then converted back to an electrical signal. This nerve conduction process occurs millions of times a second. The leftover neurotransmitter that is not taken up is then either biodegraded, absorbed, or taken back up, reuptake, by the presynaptic receptor for later use. Technical stuff. Antidepressants, particularly selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, SSRI, prevent the reuptake of serotonin. This allows more serotonin to be available, which, in theory, can elevate mood and help alleviate depression. Remember, the king of neurotransmitters related to addiction is dopamine. Although other neurotransmitters are undoubtedly involved with addiction, dopamine constitutes the lion's share of the pleasure drive we see in addiction. Internet screen use elevates dopamine reception at the postsynaptic receptor in the nucleus accumbens, and over time, there is an upregulation of these postsynaptic receptors to manage the increasing level of dopamine present in this area of the brain. See the nearby sidebar, The Role of Upregulation and Downregulation in Addiction, for details. The Role of Upregulation and Downregulation in Addiction. As a person increases dopamine in the limbic reward system of their brain, this translates into increased pleasure. Not surprisingly, pleasurable behaviors tend to be repeated, especially when there is an unpredictable or variable element to the pleasurable hit. Biologically, this is where upregulation and downregulation come in. As the nucleus accumbens is hit with signals that increase dopamine, the postsynaptic receptor binding sites, call them Pac-Men as in the video game, first begin to upregulate, become more plentiful, and are constantly occupied by dopamine. The receptor sites then slowly respond less to the same levels of dopamine. This is called downregulation, or desensitization, and it makes sense that this would produce tolerance, meaning that you would need more stimulation to get the same effect, which I discuss earlier in this chapter. This is because to keep those neurons firing, they now need more stimulation, and this increase produces downregulation or desensitization. With technology and screen addiction, this might mean more intense or stimulating content, faster internet speeds, quicker access, more frequent use, or longer use times, all of which we tend to see with internet and technology addiction. All this can lead to the development of reward deficiency syndrome, which occurs when the reward center acclimates to that intense level of stimulation and only receives a significant dopamine hit when engaging in excessive or intensive screen time. By comparison, everything else looks and feels flat and uninteresting. This is a very common complaint from parents and family members where their addict loved one no longer takes pleasure in any previously pleasurable behaviors. This is essentially an example of downregulation, in that when those hungry Pac-Men are consistently fed, they need more stimulation to get the same effect. Real-time living no longer provides the stimulation necessary to fire those neurons in the nucleus accumbens in order to help a person feel good or to experience pleasure from normal living. Those receptors become used to being occupied, and they become accustomed to the resulting increased dopamine levels. Unless the person is continuously excited by repeated internet or screen use, they experience a biological deficiency in the form of psychological symptoms, such as boredom and feeling blah, anxious, irritable, unmotivated, or even depressed. This is a tough place to be because there is a high likelihood of relapse at this time. We generally want to feel good, and the quickest way to feel good is to engage in the behavior that we know will get that result quickly. It's also a difficult time because the motivation to engage in other real-time behaviors that could eventually prove to be fun and stimulating, dopaminergic, is very low, and it also takes some time for the receptors to re-regulate. This creates a challenging period for the addict and their family, as it occurs between the discontinuation of the old behavior and its resulting neurochemical effects, and engagement in the new behavior with its more balanced neurochemical state. This new desired state of upregulation is sort of the opposite of downregulation on a biological level and involves getting the dopamine receptors in the nucleus accumbens to resensitize to more normal levels of real-life stimulation. The internet is very stimulating, and things like video games, YouTube, pornography, or even social media can retrain our nervous system to get used to that stimulation. Recognizing the mind and body aspects of addiction. Remember, so what does all this talk of evolution earlier in this chapter have to do with addiction anyway? Well, the brain's ability to use dopamine to ensure certain survival behaviors can also be stimulated by other pleasurable behaviors. It seems that drugs, alcohol, sex, food, gambling, the internet, pornography, video gaming, and even social media all elevate our dopamine levels. Addiction is in part related to becoming habitually dependent on this elevation of dopamine. This, along with various psychological, social, and behavioral factors, produces the experience we classify as addiction. What we get addicted to is the dopamine, and even more so, the anticipation of that dopamine. This, along with other brain chemicals, hormones, and behaviors, essentially hijacks the reward circuits in the brain that are meant to increase our survivability. This means that to the brain, addiction is a misguided piggybacking of survival drives. This piggybacking of the reward neural pathways leads to a common misunderstanding about the biology of addiction, because we often wrongfully assume that we get addicted to a substance. However, that does not account for behavioral, process addictions, within which internet and video game addictions would fall. This is also true for some of the other behavioral addictions, including sex, food, and gambling. The brain, when excited by a video game, doesn't look much different from the brain ingesting cocaine, eating a great meal, or having sex, although there may be differences in the overall level of dopamine innervation. These differences are relevant, of course, and dopamine is involved in all these behaviors and is linked to our survival, as I explained earlier in this chapter. The following sections go into more detail on how the brain is susceptible to addiction. Being wired to maximize pleasure and minimize pain. Warning. The problem here is that, in a sense, our brains act as if our addictive behavior is enhancing our health and well-being. However, this couldn't be further from the truth. Perhaps this is partly why most addicts take a long time to reach a point where they see how the harm overrides the pleasure they are receiving. Some might call this process denial, where our brain is on autopilot, engaging in a dopaminergic behavior that tricks it into acting on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.